We also want to, you know, tell you that we are streaming into 60 million homes. So you can find the nonprofit show now on Fire TV and Roku. I just say nonprofit, or even better, the nonprofit show, and voila, we pull up. So Sky, you've got to check this out, because I'm going to tell you, I was over in a staff meeting with Julia the other day and Kevin, and we did just this, and I was fascinated. So you've got to check it out. It's really amazing. So check us out on Fire TV and Roku. Our presenting sponsors, you can see on the screen here, we really appreciate your investment in this conversation and all that you do for this nonprofit sector to keep us going, to keep us navigating through these uncertain times. Without you, we wouldn't be able to broadcast every weekday live from our studios to your home or your office. So thanks so much to you for being our presenting sponsors. As always, we usually have Julia, but today Julia is doing another show. She's actually a panelist for a conference today and tomorrow. So I'm Jarrett Ransom, your nonprofit nerd. I will be the host for today. Thrilled to have Sky. And before we even opened up the digital doors, you know, Sky and I go way back. We've been longtime professional colleagues and friends. And I said, Sky, when the cat's away, the mice will play. So we're really excited to have you, Sky. I know that you came on, I believe you did, as a guest when I was on vacation over the summer. So just thrilled to have you back. I want to tell all of you watching the episode, Sky will be back tomorrow. So we're doing something new. It's a two-part series. So at the very end, we'll have the to be continued. So we're thrilled, Sky. So thank you so much for joining us. For those of you that may not know Sky, she's an amazing HR consultant and leader in the sector. She's got a depth and breadth of knowledge in the nonprofit sector. And today, Sky, what are we talking about here? Preparing a new job search?
Yes, absolutely. So I also am a career and leadership coach. And so I work with folks in helping them find more happiness in their workplace or find a new job.
So right now during COVID, I mean, is now really a good time to start preparing for a new job search?
Well, unfortunately, so many have been told they don't have a choice, you know, so yes, they've kind of been thrown out into the world of looking for a job. And so, you know, it hasn't been a choice for so many. But for others who are, you know, say unhappy in their current position, is it the ideal time to look for a job? No. You know, in a lot of job roles, such as recruiter roles, can be really tough right now. Obviously, the service industry has been hit really hard. But I am still seeing movement and recruitment, especially among the hidden job market, which we'll be talking about tomorrow when we talk more about networking. But there is still movement in especially leadership roles, technical roles, those types of roles.
Wow. You know, so one of the things that I get asked a lot, and maybe you do too, especially as a career coach and leader, is so many corporate leaders looking to get into the nonprofit world. And so what I have seen happen, Sky, during this time, since the middle of March, we've all been navigating these uncertain times, is so much personal reflection of, is who I am and what I'm doing where I want to be? Or do I want to make a career move? And is now the time to really focus and to enter the nonprofit sector?
Yes, it's so interesting you say that, because I've had two clients alone this last month who are not only looking for nonprofit roles, but also these purpose-driven roles that are popping up in the for-profit sector, foundation roles, employee donation program roles, events and education and in the tech world is really big right now. So yeah, it's interesting. And the cool part is, the part that people find hard to believe when they talk to me, is that your strategy in terms of your positioning, like your resume, your networking strategy, they're all the same, regardless of looking in the nonprofit sector or in the tech sector. So that's the cool part, is you don't have to necessarily make a decision. Like, I'm only going to position my materials and my job search toward this type of role. You can broaden it a little bit while still being targeted and focused.
That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, recruiters are recruiters. Applicant tracking systems are applicant tracking systems. Hiring managers are hiring managers. But I know that's a hard thing, because people are like, no, but nonprofit sector is so specific. And it's like, well, it is. And you have to target your job search strategy toward the sector. But like, resume format, LinkedIn networking tips, the words you use, the methodology you use is the same across industries.
Wow, that's wonderful. So you're right. This is a two-part series. Today is really about preparing for that new job search. And in that, talk to us about resilience and, you know, like, how much of this do we need right now?
Oh my gosh, resilience is the number one most important thing to your job search.
Okay.
So the ability to bounce back quickly after disappointment is how I define resilience, is critical, because guess what? The job search is full of disappointment. Unfortunately, not all companies and organizations treat their applicants like customers, which they should, because it's, in my opinion, a customer service process.
Absolutely.
I often say, you've heard me say it before, if companies were to treat their actual paying customers the way they treat applicants, they would go out of business. So that's disheartening, though.
So
when
true,
you,
Sky.
Yeah.
And I can't tell you, and I know so many people watching either now the live broadcast or the recording later will say, I have sent so many resumes, so many cover letters, and I never heard from the company.
Yeah. Or even worse, they interviewed me and told me they'd get back to me on Friday, and I never heard back ever.
Yes. That is worse.
Yeah. And it happens. I do notice that purpose-driven businesses, small businesses, nonprofits, in my opinion, tend to be better at the customer service aspect. Maybe I'm a little biased.
That's good to hear. I'm really glad to hear that. So go back and say, I mean, there was this comment, and you probably, you know, don't even remember what you said, because you probably say it so often, Sky. But if companies were to treat their applicants like customers,
they would go out of business. Or if they treated their paying customers the way they treated their applicants, they would go out of business. But they should. It's a customer service process, right? So to your point and to your question, if they were to treat applicants like customers, folks would hear back. They would receive feedback on why they didn't get a call. Most of the time when folks aren't getting a call, it's because they're presenting a resume as a life story or as a career story, rather than telling the person what they need to hear in order to make a decision. So sure. Like, just like when you're working with a client, you're not going to give them a ton of information that they don't need about your program. You're going to tell them about the program as it applies to them. Well, it's the same thing with job search. Folks will put in, say they'll be applying for a nonprofit program coordinator role that has to do with volunteer management, and you won't see the word volunteer management anywhere on their resume. And then you talk to the person, they're like, oh yeah, I managed volunteers at, you know, this organization. And so a lot of the time, you know, unfortunately, I think everyone should always receive a response, but unfortunately they're not receiving a response out of the gate because their resume really wasn't targeted toward the job that they were applying for.
Yeah. So that makes really that resilience, as you said, one of the most important things when it comes to this job search time.
Yeah, because you're going to be dealing with a lot of disappointment and you're not going to hear back. You're not going to necessarily always get the job you want. So you have this need to stay tenacious, consistent, and positive. It's just like those folks on the call right now who've started a nonprofit or started a small business. You remember at the beginning when you're like, oh my gosh, I'm doing all these things and I'm not getting a response. Well, with the job search, it's the same thing. You have to stay consistent over a period of time, but staying consistent can be hard. So that's why I recommend getting peer support from other job seekers that are out there, getting a coach to support you. You know, just making sure that you have some sort of external support to help you stay resilient in the job search.
Great tips. I love that. Thank you so much. So how do you identify this next career opportunity?
This makes me so excited because to me, this is like the biggest mindset shift for job seekers everywhere, including myself when I'm looking for work or when I've been looking for work in the past. We have this tendency to think there is my one purpose out there. There's the one job that is going to be my absolute next best opportunity. Well, to me, the book Designing Your Life, and now they have Designing Your Work Life, is mind-blowing because I think it's in chapter 4 of Designing Your Life. They go, guess what? There are multiple best options. And they're nice. Right. There are multiple best options for your next best career opportunity. And so it's
another
really,
fish in the sea kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly. It doesn't have to just be, there's a one dream job for me out there. There's actually multiple bests. And so getting with a coach or a peer and identifying, I would focus on two. I wouldn't go, you know, hog wild at the beginning. Although usually with my coaching clients, we just put everything on the board. Let's put out all 5-10 jobs that you're interested in on the board. And then once we start going through an assessment process of which one actually feels the best to me, like when I start thinking about feeling and I use this practice that really helps them to visualize the job itself, then we narrow it down to 2 or 3 at most and create a plan around those 2 or 3 to really help target, to identify and find your next best job.
That is so different than I think how I was taught and trained to look for a job, because it was so much so of send out everything, like send it to everyone, blast your resume, send emails, go on every platform possible. And it was a numbers, you know, it was like, how many resumes could you send out today? And I love that you're really focused on not only like a strategic focus for your next best career opportunity, but truly looking at what feels good. Where do I want to go?
Absolutely. Because when I talk to folks in one of our first sessions, they'll be like, well, I want to do a project manager role or a marketing coordinator role. And then we have them actually identify those roles in the market and visualize being in that role. And they're like, oh my gosh, when I started looking at these job postings, it just felt soul crushing. And so why go out and spend a ton of time in that area when you were looking at, say, another role that didn't feel that way, that you're still qualified for? And so you're exactly right. It's like back in the day, it's really a sales approach, right? So you have companies that take the massive cold calling sales approach, like what you just described, where you're just applying for every single job you can get your name in front of, every single hiring manager. Whereas now it's more of a, who's my target client? Who do I want to work with? And then positioning yourself for that position.
Oh my gosh, that mind blowing. Like just even that little tweak, I think is just phenomenal. So talk to us about, you know, okay, we figured out we want to be strategic. We want to know how this is going to feel. We've narrowed it down to those 1, 2, maybe even 3. So what strategies do we need to employ or deploy in our resumes to make them great?
Yeah. So I'm going to start before I get into the specific strategies with saying, telling you a story. So last week I was doing a resume for one of like my best friends ever. And so I was showing, you know, a comparison of here's what like a resume could look like. And here's what a LinkedIn profile could look like. And then I pulled up mine and I was like, here's what my resume looks like and my LinkedIn profile looks like. Noticeable differences. And do you want to know why? Because I'm convinced it's very rare that a person can write their own resume. So I'm actually, next time I submit for a project and they require a resume, I think I'm going to outsource it because there's such a notable difference. And I'm like, and then I go to sit down and write my own and I feel this level of resistance that is just beyond resistance to writing my own resume. So the first tip I have is if you can afford it, and there are some affordable options out there, outsource your resume. Get someone else to do it because it isn't your career story. It isn't your life story. It isn't everything you've done. It isn't you know, every job duty you've ever had, it's results, it's achievements. Yeah. And we struggle as humans. And I find, especially with my female clients, they really struggle taking credit for achievements and putting those in the forefront of their resume. And everyone does, but I do notice it more with females. So having somebody outside of you do that is really important. So hopefully, you know, either your company is providing some outsourcing services if you can't afford to get your resume done, or you can go to the Department of Labor. They have resume classes there and people who will review your resume for free. So there are options, but outsource it, get external perspective on your resume. That is my number one strategy to making your resume results oriented, achievement oriented, and effective in your job search.
Great tip. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, that's great. And so two more, right? Mm-hmm. That was one.
Yeah. And so the next is just so simple, but so meaningful. And it is, you need numbers in your resume. And here's why. Recruiters are looking at your resume in under 30 seconds. Applicant tracking systems are looking at your resume in real time. So focusing first on the numbers, and then the third strategy is keywords. So numbers have to be in your resume, because if you think about it, when you look at a document, you are more likely to read a line that has a number in it. Mm-hmm. And so it's also important in terms of context. So I was writing a resume for a nonprofit leader the other day, and I was like, okay, so you managed a donor database. There's a big difference between managing a donor database with 100 people in it or 10,000 people in it. Right. Or you managed an annual fundraising event. There's a big difference between an annual fundraising event with 50 attendees and $25,000 raised and 500 attendees and $1 million raise. You have to give context, and you have to give achievements and results. And one of the biggest misnomers is that, okay, well, when we put that $1 million in there, people will be like, well, I didn't raise that all alone. And it's like, nobody on earth is going to read that and think that it was just you. But the idea is, yeah.
Yes. That I'm so glad you brought that up.
Yeah. We got to put the number there. We got to give context, mm-hmm. and we got to give results.
So I'm going to fess up, Skye, because I was never good at quantifying my success and my achievements, right? And one of the things I do, and maybe you do something similar, because we both offer coaching, is I work with my executive coaching clients, and I ask them every day, every week, every month to capture in a success journal. It could be handwritten or digitally. What did you accomplish, right? So really for me, it's all about, you know, let's celebrate even the small successes, because they add up. So the reason I believe I didn't, you know, in my younger years, really capture and track and add the numbers to my resume is because I was really bad at keeping track of them.
Totally. And I love your tip and tool that you're using with your clients.
Well, you're welcome to use it.
It's so important to recognize our accomplishments. Mm-hmm. And, you know, kind of crossing over into my HR consulting work with nonprofits, small businesses, governments, this is an engagement strategy. When you put the number of clients served on the whiteboard, and you put the numbers that are in the annual report, actually post them in the office, it makes people feel like they're making an impact. And so tracking those numbers of clients served, total budget, total grants received, all those things are so important. And even the little accomplishments are important too.
Volunteers managed, you know, how many, all of that. So yeah, quantifiable data, I think is, you hit the nail on the head, which of course you did, because this is what you do. And this is your zone of genius. So moving into, you know, and our time unfortunately is running up. We're about 10 till, but talk to us about interviewing as well as negotiating pay.
Yeah, absolutely. So this interviewing is a skill just like anything else. And the way I look at the job search is really a series of building blocks. And everything starts with that resume, getting those achievements outlined, those keywords that are targeted toward the job you're looking for. Once you have that, you truly have the answers to all of your interviewing questions.
Oh, so wow.
if you do your resume right, you can have that printed in front of you in the interview, work with a coach or a peer, someone at the Department of Labor for free, to practice interviewing, because it's a skill. You want to be authentic. But you also will have all the answers in front of you, because it will be like, the question will be, you know, what's the largest budget you've ever managed? What was your biggest career achievement? What was, how many people have you managed? You start looking at it and you're like, oh, and then you can think back to, you know, when's the time I had a conflict with somebody? When's the time I disagreed with a boss? And really just practice those questions and use your resume as a building block for that. So interviewing is a skill. I have information that I coach my clients on, and as hiring managers on the call, you know this, that we've all been taught this way in which people are supposed to answer questions. Mm-hmm. And it's the STAR method: situation, action, result. And so it's still widely used, and most people will leave out that result component. And so in coaching, I walk my clients through that. We practice mm-hmm. the answer to questions through that, because folks are still widely using that in the hiring world.
Okay, curveball question, Sky, and we didn't talk about this, so I hope it doesn't knock you off your seat there. Nah. Is interviewing during COVID different than pre-COVID?
Yes, it is. The virtual interviewing process is absolutely a skill as well. Okay. So there are things you need to do, like looking the camera in the eye, making yeah. sure you have a professional background, wearing an outfit that you would if you were mm-hmm. in the interview. There's yes. all of these things that folks, you know, it's not necessarily at top of mind, but it's really important to do to stand out to hiring managers.
Wow. And then, you know, let's talk about, if you don't mind, as we have a few more minutes here, and I know you want to talk about negotiations. During my professional time, you know, I've had one-on-one interviews, I've had two-on-one interviews, and I've had the entire board table filled. So those are very different interview scenarios.
Yes. And I find that, you know, using a multi-tier approach and a group approach is usually what I recommend. I don't recommend like what I'm seeing with some of these tech companies, no offense, but just like ad nauseum, 10 different interviews. Like that's sure. just a waste of everyone's time. There's got to be a better way to decide within 3 interviews max. But yeah, the group interview is definitely something that you see more often now. You'll usually see a recruiter interview first, or some sort of HR professional like screening, then you'll go to the interview itself, and then sometimes a follow-up second interview.
Wow. Yeah. And some of those can be really intimidating. Speaking about intimidating negotiations, and I'm going to say stereotypically for women, for females, is like not our best set. And I'm not saying for everyone. I don't want to generalize it that broad, but what are your tips for, you know, okay, we've done the interview, they're offered us the position, and now it's time to negotiate.
Yeah, always, always, always get the salary range up front. So yeah. in that recruiter call, they're going to say, what's your desired salary? And you're going to say, what's your salary range for the job? And then they're going to say, well, do you have a number? Well, if you give me the range, because I mean, I need to learn more about the position in order to determine my salary for this position. And so it's very hard to negotiate at the end when you haven't even established what the salary range is at the beginning. And most job seekers are like, well, I can't ask that. And it's like, yeah, you have to, because you want to make sure that you guys are operating on the same playing field when you get to the negotiation phase. And then you're absolutely right. And it is something that is, you know, there's so many reasons for why negotiating is harder for women that are not the fault of women at all. However, in coaching and working with women and building that skill, you can get better and more confident at asking for what you deserve. And so, you know, making sure the negotiation is collaborative, that you're not coming in guns a-blazing going, hey, if you don't give me this, I'm walking away. If it's a job you want, there are other ways that you can leverage your power. So, you know, you may have multiple job offers. that's on the table, sometimes confidentially with the person who's making you the job offer, can be helpful as well in leveraging the salary that you want. And then the other piece that's huge right now is negotiating flexibility. So work from home was already on the rise, like we've talked about before. But there are people going into job offers right now saying, hey, I know you're doing work from home because it's COVID, but I'm telling you, I want work from home 100% of the time or 75% of the time. How can we work that out into the offer?
And you did a study and those results have come back, right?
Yes.
So what were those results based off of that study? I know I voted.
Yeah. So I put out to my network, I was like, how often do you prefer to work from home? And the bottom line is the results came back. People want to work from home at least some of the time. And it was usually at the 50% mark and above. People also want control over their work from home mix. And so people are like, well, I want to work from home 75% of the time, but I'd love to come into the office, you know, a half day or a day a week. And so that is very apparent that the more control people have over their schedule, in my opinion, the more engaged and productive they're going to be and the longer they're going to stay with the company.
Wow, that is so amazing. One last question, and it goes back to the salary piece. And I'm sorry I didn't ask it before you moved into that flexibility negotiation. It is really trending right now, Sky, especially in the nonprofit sector, that employers post the salary range. Can you tell us why that's important?
I love it, especially in the nonprofit world. I've been you know, saying this for a long time, and you and I have worked together in development and HR before in nonprofits. Post it, especially if you have no negotiation or wiggle room. You know, oftentimes with government clients and my nonprofit clients, it's literally that is the salary and they aren't able to move it in the budget. And so why not, you know, it's like posting your pricing as a business owner. Why not automatically have people opt out if it doesn't work for them? And so I think that that's really important. And then I love the movement towards transparency. I'm a big fan of market-based pay whenever possible. And if you can't do the market-based pay, there's other ways to make up that package for the person. But the transparency, I think, is definitely helpful to women and people of color in the market right now. You know, especially getting rid of that question, you know, what were you paid in the past? And then making a job offer based on that, what were you paid? So I'm loving what I'm seeing out there. And I definitely recommend posting the salary.
Well, Sky, thank you so much. This has truly been amazing. What are you bringing to the table tomorrow? Because this is part two. So today was part one and tomorrow is part two. So give us a little teaser.
Yeah. So today we talked about a lot of the traditional elements of the job search, but tomorrow we're going to be talking about what the job search looks like today. And that is networking and the hidden job market. There is so much opportunity out there when you get clear on your message and deploy a strategic networking plan to land your next job.
Sky, I've known you for many years, but you always amaze me. So thank you so much for being on today's episode. Everyone watching, please check out Sky Mercer. You've got her address right here. And I believe that's also your web address. So skyhrconsulting.com. Check her out. I know I'm going to go on and look at your wellness bingo because you had mentioned that. Julia Patrick, we missed you today, but we hope that your panelist session is going really well. I'm Jarrett Ransom, your nonprofit nerd, CEO of The Raven Group. And again, thanks to our amazing presenting sponsors. We wouldn't be able to continue this conversation around the nation, even around the globe, to so many of our viewers. Hey, if you haven't checked out the Atlas, I want you to do that. It's nonprofitatlas.com. It's housed under the American Nonprofit Academy website. Just got tons of information. Sky, I think you're listed on this Atlas as a consultant to reach out to. Yeah, I know I am. Julia is. And there's just so many experts out there in the different sectors and arenas willing to help you. So take a look at that. As always, every Friday is our Asked and Answered episode, now sponsored in part by Your Part-Time Controller. So if you have a question for Sky or any other of our guests, including Julia and myself, these are the ways that you can send in your question and then we can put it on Friday's show. Sky, thank you so much. And to all of you joining us today, this has been another wonderful episode. I'm already excited for part two tomorrow with Sky Mercer. I'm really thrilled to have you back. Thanks for everyone for joining us. And just as we end every show, I hope I'll make Julia proud. Stay well, so you'll do well. We'll see you back tomorrow. Thanks so much, Skye.
Thank you.